town of the good, the bad, and the weird. You either live by the gun, or you die by the sword.
Welcome to The Good, the Bad, and the Weird. I'm Nico.
And I'm Chris.
And today, we're hitting the beaches. We're tackling the first, the peak of the shark movies. We're going to watch Jaws. And from here, it's all downhill.
I wouldn't say downhill, I said down mountain. Down a cliffside.
Cliffhanger couldn't save this.
And to celebrate, I painstakingly thought of a drink to celebrate for Shark Week. So I bought Ocean Spray. In the blood color.
Oh, Jesus. It's beautiful.
Thank you. I'm very proud of it. It took multiple laps around the parking lot to think of this.
What were you doing, taking multiple laps around a parking lot?
We take multiple laps around the parking lot to stretch the legs, circulate the blood. We've been told that sitting all day is bad for us.
Oh, walking around the work parking lot. I thought you were talking about, like, driving your car around a parking lot.
No, there's other employees who do that, but I am not one of them.
Wait, really?
I think it's more of a, I'm going to park over here in the, like, shade while I do stuff in my car. But it does look like they're driving around the parking lot.
Fun.
Yeah.
Fun. Well, so, like we said, in preparation for Shark Week, we are going to be talking about Jaws today. The original, the first good and last good shark movie.
Definitely the best shark movie to so far grace the screens. And Jaws, we were watching Jaws, and I was a lifeguard for a very long time. And I remember Jaws playing at the theater pretty much every summer during what we called like a float and watch the movie sort of thing where the pool was open later, you paid a little extra. But I hadn't really paid solid attention to the movie in probably 10 years or so. I would like to question the fact that this movie's rated PG.
From my understanding, the PG-13 rating actually hadn't been invented yet. It took Indiana Jones and...
I think the Temple of Doom did it.
It might have been Temple of Doom. I think it was...
Or the Ark.
No, it was the first one because they wanted to give it a hard R rating. And Spielberg's like, maybe we should have an in-between because it wasn't a hard R, but it wasn't a PG film.
Yeah.
And so the PG-13 was kind of created because of that. So by the time that was Temple of Doom came out, PG-13 was established. And why Beetlejuice is rated PG-13, though it says fuck.
Yes. This one, despite having almost no bad language, I think at all, in it, especially for the 70s, pretty bloody for a movie.
I mean, there's a dismembered leg.
There's a dismembered leg. There's also, like, is there a hand or something? There's also a dismembered head, which is pretty gross.
Dismembered hand, too.
Yep, quite a lot of blood in the water sort of scenario. And also... two nipples. Did you not see the nipples?
No, I didn't.
Oh, you were not paying close enough attention for the nipples. It was at the very beginning. The first girl who dies.
Oh.
Yeah, there's a wonderful, like, interview with her. I guess she's, like, or was, I don't know. I haven't looked into her recent work. But I guess she was into, like, animal taming, like lions and tigers and stuff like that, and she handed her portfolio to be in the play to be that specific role, because not only could she do all the water stunts herself, they wouldn't have to get a stunt double, but she also didn't mind being naked, which was the key, like, like stumbling point. And so she put a nude photo of herself in her portfolio so she wouldn't have to get undressed at the interview.
Okay.
And was like, here. And they were like, great, someone with boobs.
Boobs. Always boobs.
Always boobs.
Actually, that's there's a part to that, too. So that's the first girl who dies, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So in that scene, too, she's... they wanted to use mechanical systems to pull her, but she's like, no, I'm not going to be tied because if something fails and she's pulled underwater, she can't get back up.
Yeah.
So it's actually her... they had rope underneath her. Two people on shore pulling her back and forth.
Yeah, I saw that. And then they were telling me that while she's being whipped around back and forth. And nowadays, her being, like, flung around is on the verge of being comedic, but knowing that she's actually tied to a rope being flung through the ocean is kind of terrifying.
Yeah.
And also makes that seem like way more impressive now that I know that.
Well, I mean, part of the reason for me some of the effects are impressive is because Spielberg didn't get his way in this movie.
No, the ocean pretty much didn't let him.
Yeah. No, the shark sank multiple times. They couldn't get it to work. And so, like, it wasn't a big part of the movie like they wanted it to be.
Even the boat sank at one point.
Yes. Yes. But for me, that's kind of what makes it so great is because, like, in God, it wasn't intentional like Godzilla where, like, you don't really see it until halfway through the movie.
Well, he wanted it to be. He wanted it originally to be like Godzilla, and because the shark kept failing and he ran out of what he called bad weather reshoot days, he decided that he was going to take a Hitchcock approach where you didn't see much of the shark, and that ended up actually being in his favor. And then something that he was like, no, I'm going to keep doing that.
And why it's such a great shark movie, because like all these other movies we see, they introduce it like right away. I mean,
or in this one, you know it's a shark from the get-go, but this one didn't have the bar to jump over for how big the shark is, slash how scary the shark is. Mm-hmm. So just a standard extra-large shark, but a realistically large shark.
Yeah, and from...
That's pretty cool.
And from what I found, sharks weren't really a rational fear of an irrational fear for a lot of people until the early 20th century when, like, I think it was in 1916, there were some big shark attacks.
Yeah. But, I mean, it's not that shark attacks didn't happen, but there was, I'm trying to remember the date. There was a specific date. Oh, it was 1975 after this movie came out. The beach attendance, like, plummeted really sharply, and a lot of people attributed it to Jaws and the fact that people were scared to go to the ocean for a while.
Well, and also the fact that Jaws was the first summer blockbuster.
It was. It invented the term because people were lining up so far around the block to get in to see this movie.
And if I remember right, this is the first movie, or one of the very first movies, that was distributed nationwide all at the same time rather than going from coast to coast.
Yeah, no. And this one also didn't try to rely on critics getting the word out about it.
No.
Because it hit all at once, it was word of mouth and the audience's decision to go see this movie, whereas in times past, you kind of waited for the review in the newspaper or the magazine to tell you, oh, this movie's pretty good, wait for it to come by, and you should see it. It also was a pretty high-grossing movie, if not the highest-grossing movie, until Star Wars, I think,
which was only a few years later.
No, but when you think of top-grossing movies, nowadays, of course, Star Wars is up there, especially with how many there are and still making them. But Jaws hadn't, like, I knew it was a big blockbuster. I knew it, like, was the summer hit. It hadn't occurred to me how much money it made, especially for how much money they spent making it.
Yes. Quick Google search. Jaws was the highest grossing film of all time until Star Wars. Jaws earned almost $2 billion worldwide in 2011 prices.
Making up for all of those sunken sharks and reshoots and going over schedule by quite a bit.
Yes, which that was one of the things, too, is we think of Spielberg as this big household name now. But when this movie came out, he was our age. He was 27 when he was directing Jaws.
And this was his second big picture or real, like, full movie.
Yeah.
He'd done a couple TV things beforehand, I think, and like some other smaller movies. But I think this was his kicking off of his career, really.
Yeah, I mean, this was his proving ground.
Oh, definitely.
And then, of course, Star Wars came out, and like they were experimental for their time. I mean, they were really pushing the boundaries of effects.
Well, and this movie, like, I didn't really think about it, especially in the world of CGI where we are, like, today.
Jaws 3.
Oh, Jaws 3. Don't mention Jaws 3 to me. But where we are in special effects nowadays and with, you know, sets and how good we've gotten at making a pool look like the ocean, it hadn't occurred to me that this was the first movie that people had truly shot the whole thing on the ocean. Which,
yeah,
that was most of their complications, was because he wanted to shoot on site instead of in a pool or at a lake.
Yeah, no, and that's the thing, because I watched a couple of the early shark films, and it's a weird thing, because like a lot of these movies all stem back to World War II, because that was one of the big things. Like, the first true shark movie is called The Shark Fighters.
Good name. Solid. I like it.
It's more of a drama about people developing shark repellent because of the USS Indianapolis, which Quince, the drunken sailor, talks about that he was part of that. That was a real event. That was the covert ship that was carrying the bomb that we dropped on Japan.
Yeah, and it was kind of a weird... I shouldn't say weird. It was actually really smart that they wrote in, and they wrote in everything last minute. It sounded like they were working on the script for the next day, the night before, which as an architect, I really appreciate.
Yeah.
Because that's how our field runs a lot of the time. But so they had a whole bunch of people all putting in lines for that one scene, for that one spiel about his military background.
Yeah.
And it made him make more sense, as opposed to just... Especially what we see now with a lot of the shark movies, where it's just, this guy's got a vengeance against sharks, he hates them, he's coming to get them, and he's maybe Australian sometimes.
Well,
this guy made sense. Of course he hates sharks.
Yeah. Peter Benchley, he was the novelist for the original Jaws book.
Yes.
And then he also was one of the writers for the screenplay.
He also is the reporter in the movie.
Yes.
Which,
yes.
Good on him for getting in there.
But, like, his original... monologue for that is like a 6-page monologue,
which, I mean, for a book though, that makes sense. A lot, like, at the time, not a lot of people really fully understood or knew the story of the ship, and so, you know, that's a lot of research you've got to, like, let people know on about. It's a lot of story, that's a lot of heartache to try and convey.
Yeah.
6 pages is nothing.
Well, from, I think there was an interview with Spielberg, and he was talking that there was a lady who came up to him and told him that her son had been on that boat and she didn't even know what had happened to him until she saw Jaws. And then that was public knowledge by that point. And
yeah,
she's like, well, shit.
It's crazy. So this movie also had a lot of firsts, not in just where it was filmed, but also it sounded like, you know, no one filmed on the ocean before. So one of the camera guys in the interview I was watching was talking about how he was like, all right, well, we're going to go film on a boat. It's going to be great. I'm sure somebody has a piece of equipment to keep the camera steady.
No.
Sure didn't.
No. And where they were filming, they could go, I think it was like 10 miles offshore and still have shallows to film in, which was key for when the ship sank and the safety of everyone on board. But the thing is... where is it? It's in Massachusetts. It's a popular community.
It's the Vineyard.
Martha's Vineyard.
Yeah.
Yeah. So they're out there and, like, they'd shoot and then a boat would come in on the horizon and they'd have to sit, let it pass, wait an hour,
and
reshoot.
None of these boats are like the speedboats at the lake down by us where they're going really fast with a tube behind them. No, these are like sailboats just out on their Sunday cruise, just like peacefully wisping by in the background. And they'd have to be like, well, that one's right out of frame right now. We got about 7 minutes before those two over there make it into the film. Can we do it?
And that was another thing with it is filming in Martha's Vineyard is that you can go back to it today and nothing's really changed that much.
Yeah.
Like the billboard, all of that was shot in one day. So all those scenes you see with it, they had to build it and tear it down all within a day because the community didn't want it to become a focal point.
Well, and also this was a lot of interruption for this small community's, like, it was only supposed to be like, what, 90 days or something like that?
Something like that.
So it was already, you know, going to be 3 months of their like, in the story, their money-making season kind of ruined by these actors in their minds. And then it just kept going. So,
but,
of course, they're not super big fans of these people.
Not at first, but I think they've come to have a, some kind of fondness to it, because one of the things they did is they incorporated people from the community into the footage.
Yeah.
And got them involved rather than like, no, we're shooting this big picture. You're not part of this.
Yeah.
But they really brought them in. And now like there's a Jaws Fest where people go and they do tours and
good for them
stuff.
Nostalgia goggles make everything better.
Yeah. And I mean, for me, because I know you've seen this movie quite a few times.
I have. Every summer, it feels like.
I didn't see this movie until like 2-3 years ago because, again, it wasn't something that was readily available to me for a good chunk of my life, which is surprising given the track list of movies that I saw way too young, thanks to my mom not reading the back of movie labels.
It's fine. Well, and a good example of like how this movie has kind of kept seeping into culture. So Universal owns this movie, and for a long time they had a ride at Universal Studios about Jaws. I have since watched it. It's now closed. You can't ride it anymore. Sad day, I know.
But, so sad.
But I did get to watch some footage of the ride. It's on YouTube, so it has been, you know, forever capsuled. But so Universal Japan, a relatively newer theme park, they rebuilt the ride, and it's over there, and it's apparently really popular. It has its own gift store, which the one in America or in Florida didn't. It apparently has its own little cafe that serves Jaws themed snacks and food, which I think is so cool.
Could be ours, a fun movie night.
Yeah. Ours, I don't remember them having that at all. It might have, but from what I remember just the ride and, like, the little entryway sort of thing.
And you're more familiar with that stuff than I am, because the closest I've ever been to Disney World is Disney World Paris. We got to the gates and the summer hours hadn't started, so we turned back and never went back.
Good. So, and this movie, despite being a very American-feeling movie, seems to have kind of progressed and kept going into other cultures, which is great. I love it. I'm glad Universal is like, yeah, Jaws! Go Jaws!
Yeah. Well, and for me, like, looking back at this, because my first shark movie was Deep Blue Sea, which is...
Oh, good.
Classic.
way to jump right in there.
Yeah, right into the swell of crappy shark movies.
Yeah.
But for me, looking back at this movie, I can see why this movie was a horror film back in the day.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
And even now, like, and I think that's why it does so well at Universal, because sharks are universal. One, I didn't realize how large a Great White's territories are.
Oh, yeah.
It's impressive. But it's a primal fear.
Yeah.
And that's why it connects with so many people on different levels.
Definitely. I also think, and I could be wrong about this, but I kind of have this suspicion that Jaws, the book, and then definitely the movie, kind of helped kickstart not only the fear of sharks, but just the complete misunderstanding of sharks.
Yes.
Because for a lot of people, sharks were just in the ocean, and yeah, they're bad, but so are jellyfish, and so are barracuda.
Yeah.
And then after Jaws, people then associated sharks with the crazy, granted, unrealistic man killer from the movie. And while Jaws's killer shark is arguably a more realistic interpretation of shark than, say, Sharktopus, half shark, half octopus, or Sharknado, or what was the one you watched where the shark's in somebody's house?
Oh, how the shitty parody film Shark or House Shark.
House Shark.
It's, if you're going to watch a shitty shark film, that is not the one. It's a really bad parody film.
It didn't look good from the snaps you sent.
It was bad.
But if people were getting their information about sharks from movies, then it kind of seems like this would be a good explanation on why the brain kickstart of sharks are bad, thus we should probably kill them before they kill us. They are coming to get us. And our children.
Have you not seen Six-Headed Shark Attack?
No, I watched Two-Headed Shark Attack, and it was bad.
They get worse. They completely skip four, but Six-Headed Shark Attack, imagine four of the heads acting as legs,
oh,
and
no.
The other two heads as attacking faces.
Oh, no. I will watch it later. It sounds really atrocious.
It's gloriously bad. It's actually probably one of the better bad ones, just for the fact that it's walking on its faces.
Ow. Poor shark. But, and now, the whole reason we're doing Jaws is because of Shark Week, which I feel is like the Discovery Channel's rebuttal against the movie Jaws,
yeah,
which was brought on because of Jaws.
Which I didn't realize Shark Week's been going on since the 80s.
It has. And this is... Shark Week is one of those things that I remember distinctly when Shark Week was at its peak. Like, people were pumped for Shark Week. Shark Week was a whole thing. And now Shark Week... There's only so much shark you can do in that amount of time.
Mm.
Like, we can only really go so far, especially with a creature that we haven't learned everything about. They swim a lot farther than we can go. They go a lot deeper than we can go.
And we don't want to mess with them for the most part. Like,
no, and they're not like dolphins that we can just kind of like corral and learn and study in a scientific manner. They're sharks. They as Spielberg learned, you cannot tame a shark. Because apparently he wanted to use real sharks for most of the movie, and learned very quickly that you cannot train a shark to do diddly squat.
And that's the thing is, like, with some of these early shark movies, people actually died in the making of them. They got attacked and killed by sharks.
Yes, because sharks, they have pointy teeth.
Yes.
Speaking of shark attacks and then, you know, real shark footage, I didn't realize that there were real sharks in Jaws. I knew that there was animatronics.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't realize that the scene with the cage, when he goes down and he's going to stab it with his fancy science equipment, I didn't realize that that's a real shark.
No, so there's actually other footage of it. So, like, one of the sharks just kind of swimming by the camera.
Yeah.
Like, the reason it looks real is because it's a real shark. That one, they actually had to rewrite that scene because, Hooper was actually supposed to be in the cage at the time.
And die, right?
I don't know.
He was going to get eaten or something like that?
No, he was just, I think he was going to get out, but he was supposed to be in the cage. But they saw the footage, and basically what happened is the shark was just swimming along, got caught in the wires, and the moment it got caught, it started freaking out.
Well, and we should make a note here. The shark wasn't a 25-foot-long shark with a full-size cage.
No.
So it was a much smaller shark, but to get the force perspective, this was a much smaller cage, mm-hmm. and they found a much, much smaller stunt double.
Yeah.
And they were very lucky he wasn't in the cage yet, because mm-hmm. the damage that you see to the cage is actually the cage. And that poor guy, I don't think, would have made it. Especially because they, for some reason, didn't think that he needed the same amount of air as a normal person.
Yeah.
And got him smaller air tanks.
Well, they had to scale it down. And on top of that, he wasn't an experienced diver. So,
shark.
Well, they said that the moment he got in the cage and saw the shark, he kind of panicked a little bit.
Which, for scuba diving, you really want to control your breath and conserve your air. Mm-hmm. And so this guy, unfortunately, ran out of oxygen real fast. So they were really lucky that he was an experienced diver and wasn't in the cage during that filming. But at the same time, now they a shark rewrote a script.
Yeah. No, but it's cool footage. I mean,
it's really good footage.
They couldn't pass it up. And I honestly, it's cool.
It's iconic scene too.
And yeah, sharks are cool. I do have to say, I love Shark Week when I had cable and like when I was.
Oh yeah, definitely.
Able to watch it.
It's a cable thing for sure.
Yeah. But some of the documentaries on it are really cool. Like my favorite one is still the South Africa sharks that just fly out of the water to kill the seals. Oh, it's great.
Well, and it was fun learning about the different types of sharks from Shark Week, because Jaws focuses almost completely on the great white. They do mention other sharks. They mention the shark with the fancy tail that whips things around.
Thresher.
The Thresher shark. They mention, I think, a bull shark at one point, potentially. Yeah. And a tiger shark. The first shark that they pull out of the water, they claim is a tiger shark. I'm not a shark expert. I don't know if that's true or not, but sure, why not?
I have a hard time with tiger sharks just because some of their patterning is rather light.
Yeah.
And I can't see the difference between the stripes. But when it's like really defined, it's like, oh, I know what you are.
Yeah. So Shark Week was always really fun for me to learn about the different kinds of sharks. And that's something that I wish even bad shark movies paid more attention to. I know there's definitely some that do throw in other shark types, but mm-hmm. the focus is almost always on two shark types, great whites and megalodons, which are yes. just bigger great whites, according to movies.
Or a slew of sharks in a tornado.
Those don't count.
Well, actually,
I feel like those are still great white sharks. They're just in a tornado.
Some of them, they've got hammerheads.
The hammerhead thing is also funny because especially watching the Discovery Channel footage of hammerheads and then the movie representation of hammerheads, I feel like a lot of hammerheads lost eyes in movies. It's a lot of head bashing that I don't think would have actually happened.
And on top of that, they're bottom feeders. So like they're not going to be, I mean, they'll still bite you. I've seen, I think on Discovery Channel, back when they actually used yes. to show people getting attacked by sharks.
Ah, yes.
The attacks from them, and it's, I mean, it's terrifying.
But also at the same time, it's kind of been nice because some of these sharks, like the hammerhead, are a little easier to track and research, while great whites definitely aren't. And mm-hmm. I feel like all of the attention Jaws gave it definitely helped people want to study them more. They're now part of culture. They're now, what do they call it when something takes on a characteristic that like makes it more likable, like pandas and foxes.
I don't know, but pandas are the worst.
Well, luckily pandas aren't in very many shark movies, if any, I think. I also learned that the mechanical sharks, which there's more than one shark, because, you know, we have different sharks doing different bitings.
Mm-hmm.
Apparently is named Bruce.
Yes.
After Spielberg's lawyer.
And apparently the guy who played Brody.
Yes.
He never used it. He didn't like that they named Bruce after his lawyer.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
But.
I also liked that, especially because this is, you know, very early in Spielberg's career. And yeah, the book was popular when it came out, but it wasn't, in the movie world anyway, it didn't sound like it was an earth-shattering discovery.
No.
So a lot of the people they originally asked to be in this movie turned it down. And so they were forced to go with, lesser-known people or, you know, town folk or the book's author for roles, which ended up being a really smart move because mm-hmm. at the time, and even still, those people weren't other characters. It was, this is a town, and the shark is the main character.
Yeah.
Which worked really well.
Yeah, which, I don't know, it's an interesting movie. I mean,
it definitely started a lot of, you know, things that we see all the time now.
Mm-hmm. And it's kind of interesting thinking about it because you really have three main characters. I mean, I would arguably say Brody is the main character.
Yeah.
Hooper's probably the next main, and then Quint, my favorite, is probably the less of the three, but he's still one of the big driving characters.
Definitely.
Favorite thing about him, dude was shit-faced all the time, apparently.
Yeah, he had a drinking problem, it sounded like.
They would have assistants follow him around or hang out with him to make sure he didn't drink. Most of the time, they would find the assistant drunk with Robert Shaw, and the whole, Indianapolis monologue,
mm-hmm.
he was actually shit-faced for a good chunk of that. Then he came back the next day and apologized, and they had to reshoot some of it. So in some of the cuts where they're looking, like, right at him, and his eyes are a little droopy and a little red, he's been drinking a bit.
But they also said that, you know, he felt so bad for having made what he felt a fool of himself while doing that shot, that when he came back and redid the shot, he was stone cold sober, but he put so much effort into it that they couldn't tell the difference between when he acted that scene when they were clipping it together,
mm-hmm.
which good on him for doing that. But also didn't he owe a lot of money in taxes and kept escaping to Canada?
I don't know.
I feel like I read that somewhere that he was in a lot of debt and, would frequently disappear to Canada to escape having to pay that. So, you know, it sounded like he was quite the character.
Yeah, I'll have to do some digging on that because I'm a little curious. But part of the reason I think this movie does so well is because, again, like a lot of these really well-written movies, is the level of characters and who you actually connect to.
Yeah. And this one did a good job of movies movies previous to Jaws that might have been on the verge of being a creature feature.
Mm-hmm.
They either took one of two routes. They were either all about the creature, like we saw in Arachnid or Arachnophobia.
Yeah.
Or they were almost all about the people, and the monster just was kind of something to move the script along.
Which is a big issue with a lot of these more serious shark movies, like The Shark Fighters, for example.
Yes.
It's all about personal drama, which the movie's boring as all hell. and then the first Jaws ripoff, Mako, Jaws of Death.
Yes.
It's all about drama. It's about a...
Yeah, even the two-headed shark movie attempted to be very much about the drama human side, which it definitely wasn't about them at all, in my opinion. The shark was the only thing I was there for. The mm-hmm. characters were horribly written, but they did their best. I felt it. But Jaws towed this line between having these characters that you really connected to, you felt that you cared about them, even the ones that you thought were kind of maybe a little bit of a dick, you still didn't want them to be eaten by the shark, whereas a lot of newer ones, I have my list set up, you're gonna die first, you're gonna be eaten second,
you should die,
and you're gonna lose a leg and then come back for the sequel. But well, Jaws didn't do that. Jaws made us love these characters while still focusing mainly on the shark.
Yeah, on finding this one creature.
Yeah.
Which, for me, I really connected with Brody when I watched this, because I'm used to being, like, the new kid in the area. And Brody, he's the new cop. He's the new sheriff. And he's trying to keep people happy. But that happiness leads to the death of a child. And so that's when he has to take action and do what he knows is best. Not what the mayor wants, not necessarily what the community wants, but he has to do it for himself. Hooper, on the other hand,
he's there.
Yeah. He's that academic who comes in and is like, I know everything about sharks.
Yes. And I do think that while Hooper's arc of a character is definitely less than the other two characters, mm-hmm. he definitely was still given just enough of an arc where he starts off very much like you said, is that I know everything. I'm the expert you called in here.
Yeah.
Why aren't you listening to what I have to tell you? I don't have time for this. And he slowly, very slowly, turns into, well, I'm already in this mess with you guys. I'm going to see it out to the end.
But in his way, too.
Definitely in his own way. He's not guns blazing sort of character. But it was just enough of a character development to make him feel real.
Mm-hmm. And for a good chunk of the movie, too, with Quint, we're thinking, oh, he's just this drunken sailor who wants to kill sharks. And then he has this monologue, which...
Oh, that's a good monologue.
That's probably one of the better parts of the movie, is that monologue. Because then... even the lead up to it, because they're having all this fun and stuff.
They are. They're having a good time for the first time in a long time together.
And then he taps Hooper on the back. And then, like, the moment he does it, it's like, oh, shit, that's right. There is this really heavy, depressing part of this movie of, like, mm-hmm. this dude was, like, one of 200 or something people who made it out of 1,000.
I don't even think it was that many.
No, it was...
It was not good. But, and again, his character story arc isn't super long. We don't really develop him other than that speech. And he doesn't even really develop. You just now understand why he is an asshole drunk.
Mm-hmm.
But that was just enough. Because, again, it wasn't about their relationships. I mean, it was.
Yeah.
We care about them. We care about those relationships. But killing the shark is now even more so a focus for the audience, because now you care about why he cares about killing mm-hmm. the shark.
Because you cared about Brody. Hooper, yep. He's there. But then it's Quint. Quint was really like... And you actually feel bad for him when he dies, because he's so worried about when he's going to be taken by a shark. And he does. And that's the crazy thing, is he went from the Navy in this traumatic event. He goes right back to the ocean.
Yeah. But he went right back to the ocean to immediately become a shark killer.
Yes.
Like... The details put into both his boat with the shark teeth, the shark jaws mounted to the front of the boat, and then letting the audience see the inside of his workspace where he is boiling sharks, I assume. rendering them down and turning them into things for tourists to collect and display really does give you a sense that this is all he thinks about and focuses about most of his day. Which is kind of sad. We also kind of get a sense of him at the very beginning when he offers to kill the shark for a much larger sum of money. But because he's sitting in the back, there's some scenes where I don't even think you can see him in the back of the room. He's sitting next to a very scary drawing of a shark. It's not a realistic shark, but it's not a friendly shark. It's not. Yeah. It's no baby shark. And so you're set up with this understanding that, yeah, this dude definitely hates sharks. He's definitely a odd character. He's definitely got some of his flaws. And then delivers at the end with giving him a purpose.
Yeah.
Which, good arc.
Yeah. And then, from Jaws, despite how popular it was, it spawned so much garbage.
I will say that I do think we're coming... There's a couple of releases that I can think of that were not total garbage. I wouldn't say they're, you know, the next Jaws by any means.
No.
But example being, I recently saw The Meg. I wouldn't say it's as garbage as something like Sharknado.
No.
It's definitely trying. It's definitely doing its best. It had good talent, good, for the most part, writing. The science in it was garbage, but at this point, I'll take 2 of 3. Yeah.
I mean, it's the deep sea ocean we've never seen before.
Oh, no, no. Their science is that there's a fake bottom to the bottom of the ocean. No, don't say that there is, because this was them going through the dirt level, not through a denser part of water. It's not more salty lower. It's they went through a dust layer, and that is what's protecting us from these giant sharks.
Yeah.
But I can overlook some bad science if, you know, the other parts of the movie are there, because I have had to live with so many bad shark movies for so long, mm-hmm. where literally all of those things are completely glossed over.
Yeah, and I knew Shark Week way before I knew I knew Deep Blue Sea first, and then I saw Shark Week.
Shark Week's a good intro.
Yeah. So, but that was way back then.
Yes.
I
also think that this movie, not only created the tropes for a good shark movie, which then everyone has attempted to live up to since, I think it also started Spielberg on a lot of his traditions. From what I understand, he didn't go to the last day of filming because he was worried that the crew was going to dump him in the ocean or something like that.
Yeah.
Which then has become apparently his routine, his custom, is he doesn't come to the last day of filming anymore. Because
it's good luck for him.
Exactly. I don't remember which actor, but one actor slept with a piece of celery under their pillow as their good luck charm. I don't quite understand that one, but I like it. It's clever. The Shooting Star was another one that this movie started for him. The Shooting Star, they accidentally managed to catch, and it's really well placed and perfect, and so they kept it. And now it's been something of an Easter egg for him to put in a whole bunch of his movies.
I don't think I caught that.
It doesn't look like what you would think of a shooting star. It looks like a red flare in the background.
Okay, that might be why I didn't catch it, because, like, when I see stars, I can't see the different colors of stars.
I forget you're colorblind sometimes.
I just see the white stars, like...
Yeah, no, it's a red streak across the sky, and I had never really noticed it, I guess, and my husband, who was watching it with me, both of us had to stop and be like, was that a flare in the background? Who's shooting flares in the movie? I believe it was supposed to be a shooting star that they had accidentally caught on footage while they were filming that, and Spielberg liked it so much that now it's kind of become something he tries to add to his movies.
Yeah, and it's interesting just to see, like, the homages that are given to him. I didn't bring it up in our Wild Wild West episode, but when they're flying out of the canyon, it's his homage to E.T.
Yes.
It was like,
Well, and then you can't talk about Jaws and not talk about the music of Jaws.
Oh, it's so iconic. Like,
It's potentially the start of iconic music in movies.
You've got, like, Psycho before then, and...
Yeah, but I don't think at any point was there a song that any kid can go ba-dum.
Without having seen the movie.
Yeah, you don't even have to know what it's about. You just know that ba-dum is something sneaking up, coming to get you.
Mm-hmm.
And the real, like, brilliance of it is there's a whole bunch of people who have studied it and looked into it about the science of why it does what it does and the music theories on why it was so brilliant. But it's so simple that mm-hmm. it's brilliant. And then to put it as a tuba playing it, as opposed to something a little higher range, like a French horn.
Or even lower, like a cello.
Yeah. It's right at that uncanniness level where it's uncomfortable. But that's the point. And I don't remember who I was listening to, but there was people who were making all sorts of leaps to, like, oh, it's right on rhythm with a shark's heartbeat, and it's right at that range that gives you, you know, the fear sense. And yeah, maybe some of those things happen to be true, but with how speedily this movie was made and written, I think it's just both pure luck and pure mm-hmm. genius that they stumbled upon the song.
Yeah. Well, and the thing with it too is that it's only used to signal the shark.
Yeah, you only hear that tune when the shark is there, which yeah. is brilliant.
It's like Godzilla's roar. Yes. Like, Godzilla doesn't have that theme song. Godzilla has his roar.
Exactly.
Jaws.
Despite what some movies have done to me this week, making me think for a brief second that sharks do roar underwater, I don't think they do.
Maybe they make some kind of sound. I have no clue.
I would like to think they make a nice choppy noise, but I am not going to go in the ocean with a shark, so I'm not going to find out.
No. But yeah, I mean, that is the shark's roar.
Mm-hmm. Apparently it has, you know, it's been on a bunch of lists of best songs, or especially best, you know, movie songs, best film scores for ages. The American film industry, I think, has it ranked 6th greatest score of all time. That's pretty damn good.
That's impressive.
And then the tuba player, his name's Tommy Johnson. I'm sure that this is, like, just gone through the roof with his career, because that was his part. It wasn't a whole orchestra set doing it like how Lord of the Rings it was, or, you know, there wasn't... That was his tuba and his two notes.
Yeah. So, one thing I do want to bring up, like, we've talked about some other horror films and
yes.
little bits here and there. Jaws as a horror film, like...
Yeah. So, and again, this is a lot of stuff, like, especially from back in the 70s, that could have just been publicity that's now turned into, you know, hearsay that... When people first saw it, like, when it was first being shown, people stood up from the audience and ran out, and some of them puked from how, like...
People screamed when the shark attacked.
Yeah. And did some of that happen? I've been to a lot of movie theaters. I'm sure somebody did, because people at movie theaters are dramatic sometimes.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I can see why that would be.
No, I mean, especially if I saw it as a younger kid, because, again, the movie was rated PG, so kids went and saw this movie.
Yeah, I was gonna say, this shares the same rating as, like, a lot of kids' films do. Like,
it also shares the same rating as Return to Hell House, where there's full frontal nudity.
It's fine. They can handle it, right?
I mean, I don't know if kids nowadays could.
I don't know. I don't know if kids from the 70s could. Maybe more so, maybe less so. I don't know.
Well...
But at the same time, I also don't think, like, it wasn't like how some movies nowadays, like, Deadpool's a good example.
Mm-hmm.
Deadpool was rated R, but it was a superhero movie, so a lot of people still tried to take their kids to go see it. And then, you know, a lot of people made a fuss about that, like, no, it's R, it's really not appropriate for your kids. It doesn't sound like Jaws had that reaction. It sounded like people took their kids to go see Jaws. And I'm not talking like your 13-year-old. It sounded like people are taking like their 6 to 8-year-old to go see Jaws. And then the kids were like, heck yes. And their parents were like, yes, let me buy you a t-shirt.
that kind of happened with Jurassic Park for me. I think I saw it when I was 3 or 4.
Good. That's a good age for dinosaurs.
Well, yeah, that was exactly my parents' thought. And I remember I was terrified to go to the bathroom for weeks.
Good.
Like, that's one of my first memories. Like, one of my first memories of a nightmare was a shark. Or not a shark. How Shark has a toilet shark in it.
Of course it does. As it should.
But I was afraid of toilets for a fraction of my life.
I understand, though. But, so, because, and I think this actually worked out for Jaws' favor, because people saw it was rated PG, took their kids to go see it, and then didn't make a huge fuss that they took their kids to go see two mm-hmm. nipples and a lot of blood and a decapitated leg, this was one of the first movies where the side hustle of, you know, stickers and shirts and posters and things that we now think of very normal as part of a big blockbuster movie, mm-hmm. this was the first one for that to make a absolute ton of money.
Did you see Adam Savage's Jaws costume?
Yes, I did. Yes, I did. It's beautiful.
That's glorious.
But I also got to see several pictures of, like, I think it might have been Spielberg standing in front of, like, a little booth display of all of the different merchandise that it was probably something like they were looking at to see if they liked it and that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. It was a lot of merchandise for back then. Like, it's kind of understandable in my mind to have been like, oh, a movie poster, a t-shirt. No, like, fanny packs, pants, and, like, everything was Jaws themed, and people wore the crap out of it.
And this is really the start of modern movie culture.
Definitely. I can definitely distinctly, like, see the connection between the dots mm-hmm. between, like, Jaws paraphernalia and, like, it's still popular. Jaws t-shirts are still, especially in, like, if you're in the movie world, that's a cool shirt. That's, like, on the same level in my mind as, like, a Jurassic Park shirt. Like, it's classic, it's classy, you could wear it to work.
There's a photo I've actually been seeing circulating around. Did you see the person who is bored so they scanned a shark's face on a copier?
No! Why would you do that?
Someone photoshopped the shark's smushed face. Jaws face.
Yes, but also think about how once Photoshop became, you know, real mainstream and easy to use, I distinctly remember nom 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 gonna get ya. Like the those two elements changed, which is kind of interesting, especially because the Jaws logo is pretty basic,
mm-hmm.
especially from someone who came from a design background like that. You know, the iconic Jaws print is the shark coming up and the woman swimming on top or floating on top with mm-hmm. Jaws written across. Jaws isn't even in a very difficult font. I mean, it definitely has its quirks that make it the Jaws font, but it's no Harry Potter font where you've got little weird lines coming off here and there.
It's not Lord of the Rings. No. It's not.
It's a very basic, straightforward font with a very basic, straightforward graphic.
Or Avatar.
Yes. Oh, God. You know they're making more of those?
Yeah, there's like 5 of them planned.
Why?
I don't know.
Well. I mean, I'm going to go watch them, but maybe not in theaters.
Yeah.
We'll see. We'll see when it gets here. But so Jaws definitely kickstarted that culture, and now, like, it's one of those things where now it's normal for you to be like, yeah, I freaking love, you know, Harry Potter. I own a ridiculous amount of Harry Potter merch. And yes. I can only own Harry Potter merch because Jaws made owning movie merch normal.
Yeah. I mean, you've seen my collection of lots of trinkety crap.
Yours is more diverse than mine.
Yeah. Yeah, I guess. But...
like, that collector's mindset of not only was it just, you know, the wearable merch, it wasn't just the movie posters, they also made video games about this movie, which you own one.
I have the Jaws for NES, and,
tell me, how good is that movie? How good is that game?
Do you remember in the movie where, you had to go and shoot stingrays and jellyfish and collect shells to power up the orca?
Oh yeah, it was my favorite part. You know, the shell-powered orca.
Yeah. Who uses shells as currency?
Well, nowadays, I don't think there's very many people. Maybe this was a confused timeline, Jaws. But, yeah, and it wasn't just for that game. Like, the list of games that it came out for, Like, in my head, I had somehow thought that there was only, like, three games, which sounded about right to me for some reason. I don't know why I thought that.
Well, I mean, you informed me. I only thought there was the one for the NES because they made every single Blockbuster.
Well, they also made literally anything that could have been turned into a video game into a video game. Like, which, like, now that I'm looking back to it, like, I owned Shrek for PS3. Like, of course they made video games about this, but it hadn't occurred to me how many they made. But Jaws isn't a very good premise for a video game.
No.
Like, at all.
No.
But they still did it. And not just once or twice like they did with, like, the Titanic games, which are also garbage. But, no, quite a few of them. An uncomfortable amount.
Yeah, and the thing is, like, the map is one screen big. You can run into Jaws at any minute, regardless of whether you're powered up. It's not like in the first Final Fantasy where you're just running around and you accidentally run into a mega weapon. You're at the final dungeon in this. This one, you're just on the ocean. It's not like you go to deeper oceans. You can run into Jaws in the shallows. Like, I got to one of the towns, or there's only two towns. You basically go from one town to the next, collecting shells and powering up.
And delivering their pizza, I also assume.
I don't know. But I left the second town, ran into Jaws right away. There's the end of my play.
I do want to play some of the other ones, try and get my hands on them, because none of them look quality. But I also kind of want to see how they do and how they play. No. But also, not only did this movie get video games, which makes more sense to me, it also has two musical ripoffs.
What?
Yeah. There's at least two musical ripoffs that I could find. I haven't watched them yet. I do plan to attempt to get to that probably whenever Guys Night is. That's what the Girls Night's going to be, is Jaws the Musical.
Force Erica to watch it. She'll just be like, what are you
but
guys?
But she likes musicals. I'll be like, Erica, we're watching a musical. By the way, it's Jaws. So it got a musical, which I think in my mind is the epitome of, wow, you're getting popular.
I mean,
especially from, like, you know, just from any time period. Like, we had Lion King the musical, so at this point, you know, sky's the limit.
And this is where the dilemma with Jaws comes from. Yes, it created the summer blockbuster. That's also an issue, because now everyone wants to have their summer blockbuster.
Now we have almost arguably too many summer blockbusters.
And then on top of that, all the bullshit it spawned.
I also love the bullshit, because not only was there the musicals and the video games, which of course are garbage, but they were also going in knowing that they were going to be a little garbage, if maybe not for the musicals. Again, I haven't seen those yet, so I don't know how much they tried on those. Those could have been legitimately good and just happened to be at the wrong time.
Yeah.
But, you know, they're pandering off of a big name. We've seen it. It's not a big deal.
Yeah.
I mean, it's going to happen. And sometimes you do get occasional pieces of gold from that sort of happenstance. But what really cements a movie to me as, you know, a classic, a well-loved American movie that everybody's gonna love and know and own, is how many sequels did it get that it didn't need? Because that's how you know a movie's made it, when they've taken a story that they don't even spend time at the end of the movie after they kill the shark explaining, oh, they made it back to town okay. Oh, you know, he embraces his wife and his son didn't die in his weird tiny boat. His other child loves him still. The town mourns for the drunk man. No, they don't do any of that.
No.
They just end the movie and they're like, tough luck.
Well, I mean, that's how a lot of movies ended, is it just ended. There wasn't a walk-off. Well, they swim off into the sunset.
They have to swim off into the sunset. But so from the end of that movie, where they kill the shark, there's only one shark, and it's not even one of the bad shark movies I've seen. There was one where the shark is scientifically made and put in a lake. It's not even like one of those. This is just a really territorial shark.
Mm-hmm.
And that was their reasoning, and that's what they stuck with for the whole movie. So they made more. Why?
Isn't the fourth one like a curse or something on the family?
I stopped watching at the third one when it was in 3D, and I don't really care for 3D movies. They hurt my eyes quite a bit.
And that one's like old, bad 3D.
Yeah, no, it was early 3D. I distinctly remember, because again, I was a lifeguard. These movies were on constantly at the pool, because what else are you going to show kids while they're swimming? And I was also one of the few lifeguards who really enjoyed staying late for, like, the parties and the open late stuff, because double pay.
I mean, that's a pretty good motivation.
It was pretty good motivation back then in high school and college to stay late. So, like, I distinctly remember, like, especially on, like, the Blu-ray ones, I think they advertised their own sequels on a couple of the copies we had. Mm. So I do remember seeing the commercials for Jaws 3D or 3-D. Because it wasn't 3D, it was a play on the name, and it was not a good play on the name. So that was where I cut the line. I haven't seen Jaws 4. I don't really know if I want to see Jaws 4, because I have effectively erased Jaws 2 and 3 from my memory. I don't remember them anymore.
Well.
So, but at the same time, I really enjoyed, Two-Headed Shark. I really enjoy the Meg. So if it's somewhere between those two bad shark movies, maybe I can, like, separate it in my mind.
No. It continues the family from the first one.
Oh, bummer.
It's a very, in my opinion, low point for Michael Caine.
Bummer. That's too bad. Yeah. Well, we'll probably not watch the second one, but oh well. Maybe if I'm really bored and I run out of shark movies on Amazon.
There's
a lot of shark movies on Amazon.
There are so many. If you're listening right now and... In July 2019, there are so many shark movies.
On Amazon streaming.
Yes.
For some reason, Netflix doesn't seem to have a whole bunch right now. But
no, everything pulls up something related to Sharkboy and Lava Girl, which I know that there's 4 Spy Kids movies.
Sharkboy and Lava Girl isn't Spy Kids.
That's no.
It's own thing.
No, but that's what Netflix pulls up because they don't have Sharkboy and Lava Girl.
But you know what? They're almost the same thing. So I see why they did it.
Yeah. No, I mean, by this point, I've seen almost every single headed shark there is.
I'm jealous. I got started late. I only saw the second one. I have been told the premise of the fourth one, and I am excited to go watch it soon. Because apparently, it doesn't... Or no, the fifth one. That was the one Crystal watched last night. Was our research assistant Crystal watched the five-headed shark movie, which apparently was more of a four-headed shark movie until you stab it, and then it has a fifth head.
Shark butt.
Yes.
Swimming with its butt.
It's fine.
Wait, is the second one's with Hulk Hogan's daughter, right?
I don't know. Maybe. Maybe. It's really hard to tell. They're all really tan, they're all in bikinis, and none of their characters make sense.
That's the one where the island's, like, getting tipped over by the shark, right?
The island is sinking because the shark is slowly demolishing the island. And they keep calling it, I think, Altoid. I don't know. It's like a mint. And I know that word. I just can't say it, so I have never bothered to learn it. But that's what they keep saying it is, to cover their butts for the fact that the shark is swimming under the island, breaking the columns of the island with its body. That's what it is. It's breaking the columns, the structural columns of the island, and slowly sinking the island, as opposed to probably what would have happened if you actually broke structural columns of an island, which is not a slow, delicate sink, but more of a...
And, I mean, it didn't take long for these ripoffs to come. Like,
no, it was surprisingly quick, because I've always associated bad shark movies in my mind with the 90s and the early 2000s. Mm-hmm. Why? I don't know, probably just when I first started watching them, probably. But, no, this was pretty quick when the knockoff Jaws happened.
Yeah, no, the first one has Jaws in its title.
It does.
Mako, the Jaws of Death. And that one is all about people. The sharks are barely in it. It's a dude who is taking revenge on people who hurt sharks because during the war he got away from these people who were trying to kill him by swimming across a shark-infested lake and meeting a Filipino shaman. Who granted him a member of the shark tribe.
Yes.
As long as he has his medallion, he can speak and communicate with sharks.
I will say that, and especially as someone who really loves bad, I shouldn't say bad, because there's always a really good example of every franchise in movies, I think. But these stereotypically bad franchises, like Kung Fu movies, specifically, and shark movies, B-horror movies. There is no genre quite as creative with its script writing as the knockoff shark movies.
Knockoff shark or just creature features in creature general.
Well, especially now, because right now I think in theaters is the crocodile or alligator.
Crawl? Yeah.
That's in theaters right now, which good on it for making it to theaters. A lot of these don't make it to theaters.
No, I haven't heard of crocodile movie until a front since like Lake Placid.
Yeah. So like definitely I feel like we've reached the pinnacle of the shark movie, which means now we're moving on to other water-based creature features. Like like Piranha was quite a few years ago.
Which is a sequel or a remake to, I think it's James Cameron's first movie.
I think so. But you know what? I only remember the one. So take that as you will.
Yeah.
It also had a couple of sequels, I think. It's been a while since I watched it. But we've definitely reached the point where shark movie no longer just means sharks. It could mean barracuda, it could mean piranha, it could mean a whole variety of fake sharks, including megalodons, who I'm 90% sure are extinct, as is everyone, I think.
Yeah, if they existed, we would know about them.
I feel like we would have found out.
Yeah.
But you know what? Ocean's big, so go for it.
I mean, we just had the second footage of a giant squid.
This is true. Terrifying.
Yeah.
But awesome. And wasn't there a shark? I think it was one of the ones, I think two-headed shark. Briefly, no, they ran over it in the beginning. The shark that was rather recently discovered. I don't remember.
Oh, yeah, it's like a really tiny one, though.
No, no, it's not. It's very big.
Oh.
And it has weird teeth plate thing going on.
Is it the glowy lip one?
Well, maybe it glows. I don't know.
The Megamouth?
Megamouth. That's what they ran over. I think some of their facts were wrong, which, by the way, that is my favorite game to play while watching these movies is... Are the shark facts?
Fun fact with Mako Jaws of Death, they're not Makos.
They're not Makos
No,
at all.
They're not the pointy face looking
bummer. Ones. There's a lot of, and like, I'll always, especially Jaws, definitely exaggerated a lot of shark facts. Mm-hmm. They didn't really have anything to go off of for the audience's knowledge, so they could exaggerate kind of to their heart's content, but they still kept it within the reality ballpark.
Yeah.
The new ones have thrown science out the window. And I love it.
Oh, it's glorious. One other little thing about Jaws, about pop culture that's kind of coming up in the true crime.
Yes.
There's supposedly an extra in one of the beach scenes who was found, like, murdered a few days later.
Oh, I didn't read that.
Yeah.
Oh, I need to find that
one. Oh, yeah.
That's right up my murder alley.
Yeah. No, I'll leave that for you to find. But like,
definitely.
I only found out about it recently, and I think it's only a recent thing too.
I was gonna say because I definitely watched quite a lot of like behind the scenes stuff for it. So the fact that that was glossed over for this movie is pretty big deal.
You won't find it in special features at all. It's all these true crime podcasts and YouTube channels that are.
I will have to look into that because back then, this is, you know, same mindset as The Exorcist time period, where part of the reason that movie was as big as it was because of all of the supposed controversy around the filming of it. And so the fact that, A, they chose not to, you know, make a deal of it at all, sounds like they attempted to actively hush that.
Mm-hmm.
If it's still, like... Jaws is how old?
But she was an extra. It wasn't like she was, like, Sharon Tate who was murdered.
Fair. Fair, but also, you know, that's some free publicity right there.
Yeah.
But also, like, it didn't need it. It didn't need the extra hype.
I think someone did die in the making of one of the shark movies. I think it was the one with Burt Reynolds in it. And they actually did use the publicity of the person's death, and he was disgusted. I think it was the director who was disgusted by it.
Yeah, which, I mean, definitely makes sense, and I understand, but I also see the, you know, the cold business side of it, and how, people are going to talk about that. And the fact that Jaws didn't need that whatsoever.
No.
They didn't need anyone to talk about it. It was already there.
Yeah, it's like in Unrest, the one I had us watch over Halloween party.
Yeah.
Where they supposedly used real cadavers.
Yeah. That was an interesting one.
Yeah.
So Jaws. Would you watch it again since you're new to the Jaws world and haven't been forced to watch it every single summer of your life?
Yes, for me, if you're wanting to like round out your film history, film knowledge, just your experience of films in general, Jaws is a staple. It is one of the must-watch movies just because, one, the effects. Also, it was shot by hand.
Yes, it was wonderful technology put in, like effort and technology made for this movie.
Yes. Two, you get to see a young director striving and doing a phenomenal job.
Despite a lot of stuff going wrong.
And just, it's an overall good movie.
It really is.
It's worth a, I would say it's at least worth one watch, if not a couple watches, or ever so often.
Yeah.
I might not watch it again by myself. I might, if I have to, if I introduce it to someone, or we're like, hey, what do we want to watch tonight? Well, let's watch Jaws and just shoot the shit while we're watching.
It's definitely a good, easy movie to watch while you're, you know, hanging out with people, especially if you've already seen it. I think that's part of the reason why it gets played at, like, the pool for after parties or just summer parties in general.
Yeah.
But as someone who's seen it a whole bunch, I think I'd still watch it again. Yeah. I think I'd keep watching it every summer. Like, I'm not gonna sit down and analyze it like I did this time.
No.
Having it play in the background while I eat popcorn and, like, chat with friends over a beer, definitely.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's... It is a must-watch.
Definitely a must-watch. If you find that you giggle a lot while watching this movie, especially at some of the effects or just chomping parts, I think you are welcome to the shark movie industry. Yes.
It only goes down the Mariana Trench from here.
It really does. If you're not sure if you like bad shark movies, I think Meg is a good second watch after you watch Jaws. Jaws is obviously the pinnacle. You can't go over it by any means. But Meg is a good entry to bad shark world. Mm-hmm. It's still a solid movie.
Because it's enjoyable. It's Jason Statham goes shirtless. He's still rocking it.
Yep. Ruby Rose is in it. So, you know, a little something for everybody. But at the same time, it introduces you to the really bad science where Jaws glosses over that. It introduces you to the, what character was that again? Why do we care that this person is dead?
Oh, this person made a stupid decision.
Oh, and the stupid decisions that are just written in, like, I don't know, taking your child to the bottom of the ocean with you. You know, those sort of things are a good introductory to then later on go down to, like, I don't know, what's the shark exorcism?
Oh, yeah, Shark Exorcist. I still need to watch that one.
Me too. I saw it, I was like, tomorrow.
One last stupid decision. Why is the mayor still boss? Or mayor? Yeah.
No, I meant to bring that up. That was something that even as a kid kind of bothered me. They definitely voted for this mayor. It's a small town.
I think he's in the sequel, too.
He's in the second one! That's the whole point that really bothered me about the second one. The only thing I remember for the second one is that he... Same character, I think, same actor even, is still the mayor, despite that the mother of that one person actively, like, coming up and bringing out the fact that they knew, and they still reelected him.
Well, we could keep talking about sharks forever. Maybe we'll make this an annual thing for Shark Week, review of the next bad shark movie. Maybe just skip right to Jaws 4.
We can skip right to Jaws 4 and the shark exorcism movie, or Sharktopus, which is, oh boy.
Oh, glorious. But this has been The Good, the Bad, and the Weird.
Thanks for listening.
Peace.